So we were talking a bit in the like the women's group about what violence means. So I was just wondering about like what does nonviolent mean? Nonviolence mean to you?
What is nonviolence to me, and where does it come from? I didn't do uni or anything, so it's just life experiences, really. I was in a violent relationship, and even though I'd left, and I kept moving, he kept finding me. So I cut off all my friends and everything. And he found me one last time. So I went to a solicitor because I needed help. I didn't know what to do. I just knew that I couldn't carry on like this. And that solicitor told me and showed me some cases of other women that probably nothing much would happen, because at the time the courts would keep ruling that it did not harm children to witness one parent being violent towards the other parent. It was only if the children were physically hurt. And I think if you've never been in an abusive relationship, you don't understand that it's not the bruises and the physical ouchies that you get. It's the mental ripping apart of you that is really hard to put back together. And that happens to children in them spaces, you know. I can remember I've said to other friends, especially if you've got a boy, I think there's only two options for that boy. Either they grow up and fight against their dad, or they become like them, you know, if that's what they're seeing. So I went to court, and it was, sorry, that's one of my youngest children. It's hard to talk about this stuff around them. So I went to court, and it wasn't just for myself. It was for my kids. It was for all them women who'd been told the wrong thing in the past, and all them kids who were just expected to carry on living under the control of somebody who was too broken to have your best interests at heart. You know, abusers are hurting themselves as much as anybody. And the judge did rule in the end that actually it was damaging to children to witness violence, and he gave me I think it was called a prohibited steps order, and said he could only get in contact through letters and stuff. And that gave me a couple of years to heal, and then I allowed him to come back into our lives, because I didn't want my child to wait until they were 16 or 17 and think he was cool like I did, you know. I wanted to be able to balance that and try and help my kids be resilient. And I forgave the man, you know. It's hard to talk about this because I have forgiven him. I don't want him, if he ever sees this, I don't want him to feel any shame. He had a shitty childhood, you know. He experienced abuse, and it's catching. But what we can't do is allow that abuse to continue, because it's not good for the people being abused, and it's not good for the abuser. So we have to get brave, you know. You have to get tough if you can. And during that court process, because it takes a long time, I made a decision, and I started sleeping with a wooden baseball bat by my front door and a knife under my mattress. And I knew that I'd fight. If he came back, I was fighting. If the courts couldn't protect me, if the legal system wasn't there, then what is nonviolence? It is, as a mum, it is putting my body between my child and the violence. You do everything you can to not be, but maybe we must. And that, for me, that's the line of nonviolence as an activist. I won't hurt anybody. I would never be physically aggressive. But our government, our establishments are facilitating social murder. They are bullying my children. They're stealing their futures. They're stealing their freedoms. They're killing their planet. So push comes to shove, my body goes between that violence that is being pushed upon my children. I stand in the way of that. I heard a lovely phrase in this women's group I'm in: the hand that rocks the cradle cradles the rock. So for me, smashing windows, a bit of pain in the face of establishments, happily killing people in the global south, happily sacrificing children there, sacrificing my children's future. It's not me who's being violent. I am standing up and doing shocking things in hopes that I will prevent further and future violence. Did I answer that?
Yes, you did very well. Yeah, it's yeah, I think a lot of it sounds like kind of yuppie hippie, and that's kind of what we're told, is that, like, you know, this is the real world, not emotions and stuff. But it's like, that's the real world as well. But just like, yeah, if you act with something in your heart, like, and that's truly what you believe, and you're doing this to stop more violence, and you're not trying to be violent to anyone else, well, that's what nonviolent is. And it's quite simple, really, isn't it? Like, people can try and put logical arguments, but this, but that, but like, but that's what it is, that's what I'm doing, and that's what I believe. And so, yeah, I might make mistakes, but that's what nonviolence is. I'm trying to do that. And like, yeah.
Yeah, and the bottom line is, like, I tried before I started throwing paint and considering smashing windows. I've tried. I've sat in them council meetings. I tried doing a hustings. You know, I tried playing the game. I tried talking to my own friends and family, and they couldn't hear me. Whatever's gone wrong in the world has gone wrong at a very deep level. They can't hear me when I just speak. But when I started gluing myself to buildings and throwing paint, the shock of my family and friends seeing me, because they know my heart, they know how anti-violent I am. So to see me doing shocking things like that, saying I'm prepared to go to prison to fight, it's helping them understand the seriousness of what is going on. I mean, Naomi Klein calls it the shock doctrine, right? They use it against us. Well, something bad like this virus happens and we're all in fear. They do all sorts of twisted things behind our backs. You know, the Coronavirus Act has been called an impenetrable mess by solicitors, and they know what they're doing. So for me, and I've seen it, you know, my family couldn't hear me before. They are starting to listen now, but it took me gluing myself to buildings, throwing paint and standing up to the system for them to realize that a peaceful, loving person like me is seeing deep, deep violence being perpetrated, not just on my children, but on all children and our future generations. And it's my duty. I can't, my friend Ben describes it like the film Sixth Sense. You know, once you've seen, you know what the hook is, you can't get it out of your mind. So once you see this, once you're brave enough to really look at it, you can't unsee the damage that's being done. And I personally can't choose to not fight back. And, you know, social history proves that this is what is necessary. You know, Martin Luther King, they didn't go to Alabama and places like that without thought. They chose the places where the most violence would be perpetuated upon them, so that people not in it could see the levels of violence that racism was causing. And this is the same fight, you know, for me, this is the fight. It started whenever women got disempowered. Something started going really wrong with our world then. And then it was, you know, black and brown people got disempowered. And this is what a nasty system does, isn't it? It sets us all off against each other. And if you allow the shade of your skin to, or the shade of somebody else's skin to allow them to be treated worse, you're allowing everybody to be treated worse. You know, if you say, well, you can have less because of that, then you're allowing that to happen to yourself as well down the road. It's, you know, same fight. And it's really important. Like I said, at first I just wanted to have my voice and my say in there, and thinking if enough of us did that, then they'd listen. But the Supreme Court has ruled that a third runway at Heathrow is okay, and they've done it on a lie. You know, they've made this little thing, oh, we didn't say 1.5, we said 2. I mean, it's all nonsense. And my gut feeling says to me that all these people know what is needed to be done, and they just haven't got the balls, they haven't got the courage. So now I feel that I need to get into them courts and refuse to go along with what Dr. Diana Warner calls the deadly pantomime, to shake up the people in them buildings, to shake up people outside, and just say all of these systems are broken. And I know change is really scary, I know it is, but that's not a good enough reason to not do what is necessary. And we're not actually asking for anything harmful to anybody. Citizens' assemblies, participatory budgeting, deliberative democracy, our laws sorting themselves out will be good for everybody. You know, so even if the world wasn't burning and about to die, these would still be good things to do. But the bottom line is, we've exceeded the Paris Agreement, we're going to hit 1.5 really soon, and it's a death sentence for many. And it's not okay. It's not okay. And if the men and the establishments can't get their shit together, then it is up to mums like me to stand between this violence and all children, because we can.